paper yet, and all I have is the, you have a cut down for the program for our WOS radio reunion and fiddling championship held 2 weeks ago at the state capitol, funded by the Missouri Arts Council. We had 48 fiddlers come to compete, and they're varied accompanists. We probably had like 130 musicians there. And I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about the radio station, WOS, which broadcast from the state capitol dome. They had the studio in the dome from 1922 to 1933. One thing I need to say about this is that people in the state who are, let's say, anyone over 65 or so who lived in Missouri at the time invariably remembers WOS, and even though it's such common knowledge to the people, it's pretty obscure in terms of scholars. I looked at a lot of books on the history of broadcasting and I found no mention of it at all. So that's one thing I'm really excited about, this as a scholar, finding out about this and being able to bring it to life. The station was owned by the State Marketing Bureau, which is a branch of the old State Board of Agriculture. And if you remember, if you know anything about broadcasting history, the first broadcast is usually given as November of 1920, KDKA in Pittsburgh. They broadcast, the historians will get me on this, but I guess Harding's election returns, would that be right? Warren Harding's election returns were broadcast on November 7th or 6th. And so I think it's significant that state government would, less than a year later, for the centennial of the Missouri State Fair, have a two-way wireless communication between the state capitol and the fair in Sedalia. The State Marketing Bureau had this equipment so they could communicate on issues of who should win what premium and so forth, and various shows at the state fair. They communicated with officials in Jefferson City from Sedalia. They had another broadcasting set, an actual broadcasting set, which was set up in the Capitol by the end of 1921, and then in 1922, purchased a, Doug, if I could have another slide now, purchased a commercially built Western Electric transmitter, 500 watts, and this is the transmitter, which was in the dome of the Capitol. And as you can see, here's the big old carbon microphone. That's where the operator would sit. This was the transmitting room in the dome. And this was only the seventh set of its kind ordered in the United States. So I think it's significant that Missouri was a real pioneer. The state of Missouri, the government, was a real pioneer in broadcasting. People were still wondering what this medium was, and already the state had a station established in the capital. The station was used primarily at first for broadcasting agricultural information. The Marketing Bureau's mission was to see that Missouri farmers knew what various prices were in markets all over the state. And initially, the broadcasts went out to a very few receiving sets. Actually, the transmitter, sort of the cartman before the horse, the transmitter was in existence before there were any receiving sets, very many receiving sets in the state. And so they would broadcast these market reports at various times during the day, and there would be receiving sets. One number I found was there were only 50 at one time while this thing was broadcasting. And these were located in banks and community buildings. The people there were instructed by the Marketing Bureau to write down the daily markets and distribute them either by word of mouth, over the telephone, or give them to the local press so people could find out what the prevailing markets were. It was hard to purchase any kind of receiving sets. And if you get a chance to look at the exhibit, there's a receiving set that was homemade. This was common that time for people to go ahead and build their own receiving sets. You couldn't buy one, and if you could, it was often above the ability of the average farm family to purchase such a receiving set, so they built their own. And one man told me that all you needed was a roll of spool of wire, an oatmeal box, and piece of crystal. And you see the one receiver set in our exhibit out in the lobby, you see that's basically all there is to it. The crystal was lead ore, or galena, and it's sensitive to radio waves. In other words, it's a detector. And by taking a wire, which was just a piece of steel wire, and poking around in that crystal, the wire, of course, was connected to the spool of copper wire, which is wrapped around the oatmeal box. By poking around on this crystal, you find a hot spot. You listen through your headphones, jab around until you found a place that you could listen to the station. And they really had to go along out of their way to find the crystal. Of course, most people told me that they just picked it up off the ground out somewhere on their place, because galena is so widely distributed in the state. Some more things just about, why don't we flip to another slide? I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. Okay, this is the power room in the Capitol building that powered the station. This is a DC-AC converter. In other words, the Capitol at the time had its own power plant. There was no power plant in Jefferson City. They had their own system of power generation, which produced direct current. Well, if you know anything about radio, it's an oscillating magnetic wave, so you have to have alternating current to produce this. And what this is then is a direct current motor powered by the Capitol's own power plant, turning an alternator, which produced the current to run the station. Okay, could I have another slide? This is the tower, which, we can kind of make out the Jefferson City Bridge here. This tower was on the northwest side of the Capitol, right of the Union Pacific tracks, ran right underneath, right below the tower. Let's see if I can remember my numbers. I think it was right around 300 feet above the tracks below. I have another shot there. Okay. Here's the Capitol itself, of course, and here's the tower off to the side. The antenna for WS, you can't see it in this picture. The man who I got the photo explained to me probably what happened was the wind was blowing on the day they took the picture, perhaps, and the antenna wire were vibrating, and so they wouldn't pick up on the photograph. But the antenna was a mast-type antenna. It was tethered to this tower. This wasn't an antenna tower in the sense we think of today. This was a mast to hold the antenna up. The antenna stretched up to a point on the dome, and it was essentially just three wires, held kind of like a clothesline, three wires extending out, and that was the antenna. But he said it was, you know, readily visible if you're standing on the ground around the cap. How about another slide? Okay, this is the interior. This is the studio. You can kind of make out an edge here, a border like a sill. That is a window that you can look into that transmitting room we saw first, so that the person operating the transmitter could see what was going on in the studio. And there were a lot of things broadcast from WOS from the studio. As I said, the market reports were the first thing. That would just be the man in the operating room reading the reports. But the programming was soon expanded and included such things as programs by various state agencies, religious services from different churches there in Jefferson City, and often those were by remote using telephone lines in the town. They would send the telephone signal from the church, wherever it would be in Jefferson City, to the studio and broadcast it that way. Also, MU football games were broadcast, and I think there's a reference on the exhibit to when the first one was broadcast over WOS. One of the most interesting broadcasts that I ran into, or programs that I ran into while looking through the WOS program guides, was one the Chevrolet Motor Company band broadcast from their plant in St. Louis over telephone wires. And they, apparently everyone had a band back then, the railroads and the automobile manufacturing plants. It was very popular to have a brass band of some type. The call letters of the station came to stand for Watch Our State, and that's what announcer J.M. Witten would tell people who were listening in to WOS. And I happened to run upon a recording just by chance at a yard sale in Columbia. It's a 78 RPM record. Just, I mean, totally by chance of J.M. Witten announcing. And this is probably the only voice recording of the WOS announcer. I'm going to play that for you now. He's announcing for a penitentiary inmate. Could I have another slide, Doug? I think I'm going to get that. Okay. Well, there's an update of the WOS studio. They improved things. This is about how it was looking in 1927. The previous picture was from 1924. So they made it a little more luxurious. Spent a little more of the taxpayers' money to get the grand piano and all. Okay, go ahead. Okay, I'll have to, what am I going to say about these? I want you to see a picture of this prison pianist. But this is A.T. Nelson, Arthur T. Nelson. He was the commissioner of marketing. Here he is, the caption of this photograph, which was in the State Historical Society. He's reading the letters of fans of WOS who are writing him these thousands of pieces of mail they allegedly received every day. He's reading this mail from the fans. This man was from Lebanon, Missouri. He was appropriate that he was on the marketing bureau because his nickname was the Apple King of the Ozarks. Apparently he was a very successful orchardman down around Lebanon. Okay, can I have another slide? Okay, there's the announcer, J.M. Witten. And then you can see again the big carbon microphone. Go ahead. This is Robert Engler. He was the engineer of WOS at the time. Okay. This is Virgil Combs. He was the cornetist and band leader of the State Prison Orchestra. And that'll be the next slide. As the State Prison Orchestra. And they were very popular in Jefferson City. This orchestra existed before WOS came into being. I found some, from around 1919, some newspaper accounts of them playing on the lawn of the Capitol in the summer, putting on concerts and so forth. But they also played a lot on WOS once it got going. Okay. And this is the State Prison Band. This is okay, you can see the slides. They didn't know how to spell Missouri, they spelled it backwards. That's quite all right. That's okay. But this is like the pop band that the state prison had. In other words, they would play all the popular pieces of the day. The orchestra was more oriented to march and orchestral kinds of performances, but they would play all the shrilling saxophone type pieces that were popular in the early 20s. And now here's the man I want you to notice. That the piano back there is Harry M. Snodgrass. Go ahead. And there he is. That's Arthur Bittner, an inmate in the prison playing the violin, but the man I'm interested in telling you about is Harry Snodgrass. I know he's not a fiddler, but the title of his speech is kind of misleading, but anyway. Snodgrass, inmate there, I've got his recording here. Why don't we listen to this and I'll tell you a little bit about him. This is announcer J.M. Witten announcing for Harry Snodgrass on this 78 RPM recording. Made around 1925.
The ivories while broadcasting from WOS, Jefferson City, Missouri, will play the prisoner's song.
Virtuoso that they immediately started letting him play on WOS and he became very popular. And one of the articles I read mentioned that people wondered at the time, you know, how a guy with such talent could have gotten into trouble and been put in jail. And so they started receiving a lot of letters saying, you know, let this guy out of prison. And eventually they had to take him off the air because people were making such a stink about him being in jail. He was such a popular performer. And in fact, he was popular all over the country. In fact, I got a letter from Grandpa Jones, who had listened to WOS in the 20s. He was living in Tennessee. And Harry Snodgrass was one of the people that he remembered most especially as playing at WOS. When Snodgrass got out in 1925, J.M. Whitten divorced his wife, and he and Harry went on the vaudeville circuit. And I guess that's where this recording was made while they were touring the vaudeville circuit. I don't know whatever became of them. I would mention one more thing about this, too. He's playing the Prisoner's Song. That's, you know, not some old favorite, of course, from back then. That was a hit. This Vernon Dalhart came out with that just a year before. So he was playing the hit to it. One of the most popular kinds of music, however, on WOS was old-time fiddling. And the first performance is Mr. Wolfe here. I was going to mention that the first performance of fiddling on WOS was, could I have another slide? I think that's coming. Okay, that's a crystal set someone owned in Jefferson City. I probably should have been ahead of that. Go ahead. Okay, here's the first performers at WOS. This is June 24th, 1923. If I'm right, that even predates WSM, which was in November of 1925. Now, why Jefferson City isn't the country music capital of the world today, I don't know. This is on the far from left to right is Louis Barton, the fiddler, George Shrimp on the bass, and Brian Williams on guitar. Have another slide now. This is Captain Jack Heine. I've got his picture in here because, well, for one thing, he was an announcer at WOS. He was a journalist from Kurtzville. He was a captain from the Great War, of course. And but he's the one that was most remembered by the fiddlers I talked to. They called him Cap. And just everybody I talked to who remembers this man spoke very highly of Captain Heine. In fact, Lyman Enlow, a fiddler from Kansas City, he originally was from the Eldon area and, in fact, lived in Jefferson City at this time. He played the tune called Back in 89, and he told me, he was one of our participants in the reunion 2 weeks ago, and he told me at the reunion that Captain Heine named that tune for him over the air. That they're up in the studio, and he asked him, well, Lyman, what are you going to play next? And he said, well, I don't know. I'm going to play a tune, but I don't have a name for it. And he said, well, it's called Back in 89. That was in 1927, and he still calls the tune by that title. Okay. This is the masked fiddlers gathered in the Capitol Rotunda for the state championship, December 31st, 1925. And from everything I can gather, this was the first fiddling contest held for broadcast over WOS. There's 85 people in the photograph, and in fact, this photograph is part of what got me interested in doing this project. About 4 years ago, I got a hold of R.P. Christensen's record from University of Missouri Press, and just one section of this photo is on the cover. And the idea at first, of course, was just to identify the people in the photograph. It's now become a basement full of stuff. Okay, I need another slide now. Okay, I've pulled out some people. These faces might not be very clear, but this is W.O. Hickam. Go ahead to another slide. These aren't going to work out great. This is W.O. Hickam. He was 91 when this photo was taken. He was at our reunion. He played on WOS as early as 1924, kind of as a program guy. And he's still living and playing. I want you to hear him play a couple of tunes. I might run out of time, but I'll try to let you hear a little bit. This first tune he's going to play is called The Stars and Stripes Waltz. It's one of the most popular waltzes performed over WOS. It's very seldom heard today.
When was this made, Charlie, this recording?
This was made in 1983, summer of 83. Yeah, I went to his home. Or, no, it's summer of 81. I went to his home. He lived in Jamestown in Monaco County. And he was 91 at the time. Oh, don't turn it up. WOS when he was 17 years old. He's in that contest photo. He lives in Jefferson City still. And he's the nephew of another very famous fiddler, Tony Gilmore. And both of them played over WOS. Go ahead, sir. Okay, there's someone doing some field work. Go ahead. Go ahead, Doug. And Jimmy's also a luthier. Okay, this is Dolph Wilson, W.R. Randolph Wilson from Linn County, Missouri. And the point I guess I want to make with this is that fiddlers from all over the state play at WOS, not just people in central Missouri. Also, the bulk of the names I ran into in the program guide can be associated with Callaway, Boone, and Cole County right in the center of the state. People came from all over, and Linn County's way up in north central Missouri. I think I've got a total of like 60-some-odd counties, Missouri counties, represented in the 11 years that WOS was on the air, of fiddlers and string bands and so forth. Go ahead. That's Niall Wilson, the son of Dolph, standing in front of father's photo. He was a participant in our reunion at the cast. He still plays a lot of his dad's good old tunes. Doug? There's the photo again, Doug. Okay, that one's not. Go ahead. Go ahead. This is Virgil Smith. He's a fiddler in Montgomery County, Missouri. There's his fine violin collection. He's probably the main living exponent of the music of a man named V. Laddie, who's a very famous fiddler from Callaway County, who won several of the fiddling championships held at WOS. And he's one of the most remembered of the WOS fiddlers. He's now deceased. V. Laddie is. Mr. Smith is still with us. Go ahead. And there he is with his fiddle. Okay. And go ahead. Okay, that's the winner of the contest in 1925, Thomas Jasper Massey, who is from Nevada, Missouri. And I talked to several of the fiddlers. They said the reason the old man won was that he was from Nevada. That was a big town. Voting. Several people I ran into who remembered the guy said he really couldn't play very well. He 70 at the time. The voting in these contests was by, the judging was by vote of the listeners, with one account said that postcards was 1 point, a letter two, a telephone call three, and a telegram was worth 4 points. And in fact, I have an account of a man, a tavern owner in northwest Missouri, who actually gave money to his patrons and kin to vote for him, but the plot didn't succeed. He didn't win the contest. In this particular contest, there's another group from that contest, the Stark Brothers there from Columbia, another well-remembered group of old-time fiddlers. The voting or the judging, it took the Marketing Bureau officials 13 days to count. They received some 5,500 communications from people all over the country voting in this first contest. Go ahead. Okay. Louis Barton's group was in that contest. Go ahead. Now, this is going to be of interest, I think. This is the Fiddlers in the 1926 Interstate Contest, which was held a few months after this other big contest. In this one, the governors of all the states surrounding Missouri selected a two-man fiddling team to come to the capital and compete with Missouri's duo, which was selected in an earlier contest held in February, a couple of months before this. And there were some, you know, very noteworthy people, and I think that attended this, and I think the bearded man in the front row is Uncle Jimmy Thompson, if I'm not mistaken. It could be. He was at this contest. He was listed as playing. Uncle Jimmy Thompson, of course, was the first fiddler to play at WSM Grand Ole Opry in Nashville, and he was selected by the governor to come up here and compete in this contest. The winner of the contest, go ahead. There's the winner of the contest, Daniel Boone Jones. He was from Stevens, Missouri, which was just north of Jefferson City. And I would mention that in Mr. Wolfe's article on Uncle Jimmy, he says that since the contest was judged by amount of applause and messages received, Missouri fiddlers had the edge. we know a better way to run contests in Missouri than that. You know, we'd never rig it or anything like that. In fact, the one newspaper account says the reason that fiddlers in the southeast didn't do too good was because of the weather. So we blamed it on the weather rather than any kind of home state edge that the fiddlers might have taken. Go ahead, then. Okay, just one final thing I want to mention, and I'd like to play the recording, but I don't think I'm going to have time. This is a black fiddler, Bill Caton, who was very popular over playing at WOS. He was from Callaway County, Tebbets, Missouri, which is right on the river, just the other side of the river from Jefferson City, as a matter of fact. And there were a lot of black fiddlers who played at WOS, and there were a lot of black fiddlers around then. I don't know of any today. I know of one man who's over 100 years old who can't play anymore. He's the only surviving black fiddler that I know of. But I just wanted to make the point that that was once a very important tradition. I guess, you know, it's all but gone. That's about all I had to say about this. I would mention that the reason the station went off the air, from all I can find, is nothing more than the Depression. In 1933, governments kind of had to pull in and reorganize. The State Board of Agriculture was abolished, and along with it, all its divisions, including the Marketing Bureau. The radio station equipment was given over to the Highway Patrol for broadcast of police posting, and that was the end of WOS. I guess the most important thing about the station, in terms of old-time fiddling, since that's the main thing I'm supposed to tell you about, for one thing, is looking at the program guides. That was the most exciting thing. They used to send out this document called the Missouri Marketing Bureau. Anybody in the state can receive it free. The Marketing Bureau Bulletin, excuse me. Anybody in the state could receive it free, and in that bulletin was all the WS program listings. And so, from gleaning through 11 years of that, month by month and sometimes week by week. They broadcast, they distributed weekly for a while. I pulled out over 200 names of groups and individuals, not only fiddlers, but a lot of popular music groups. And that's how I know there were some 60 or so counties represented. But I think the important thing, one important thing that I find from that is the existence of a string band tradition in Missouri. The string band tradition in the Southeast is well documented with 78 RPM recordings, but there wasn't much of that done here in Missouri at that time. And that's one of the most exciting things about this. See that there was a tremendous string band tradition here in Missouri, and it existed not only in the Ozarks, where you might expect it to be popular, you know, from the carryover from the southern region, but also there were a lot of string bands in the northern part of the state as well, playing a different style of fiddling, if you will, but there were string bands nonetheless. Also, I think WS represents an important first heavy influence of technology on fiddling style and repertoire. And in fact, I think Missouri fiddlers distributed their playing to the whole country over WOS. And many of the master fiddlers of today, I believe, take a lot of their playing from having listened to the radio champions of the big names in fiddling in that day. In some ways, you know, fiddling might have been homogenized a little bit by WOS, or fiddling from one region today. And finally, one thing that stands out for me and is most important in this whole thing is from the people I've talked to is that it was just a heck of a lot of fun for fiddlers to go in and take over the Capitol building once a year contest, and also it was exciting for them. Many of the people I talked to said that they remember that as one of the most enjoyable and important times in their lives, their experience playing up there in the Capitol. It was really exciting. Any questions?
Does the fiddler travel all
different parts of the world? Yes, he's one of the people in the United States. Carried. In fact, I guess at the time all the stations had clear channels, and so it was tough to stop.
That's the man I was talking about. Oh, yeah. Fact, he lives in Jefferson.
He also humored plays it too. Maybe he's heard it called Driver too.
No.
Next time he's out, he'll be able to play it for him.
Well, that's the man I mentioned. I'm still living in that. He's over 100 years old.
He's a legendary figure in Marion County because it's the Roman Black family that had that county practice. Like all of them.
Yeah, thank you for those. You've been impressed, right? It's still better. Bill would tell
telling me about the days he had spent as a young man playing with a band called Skillet Lickers. Now, if you all don't know who the Skillet Lickers are or were, they were the first really successful fiddle band in American music. They spent a lot of time making hit records for the old Columbia label, and they spread a lot of good tunes and music around the country. By 1927, the Skillet Lickers had gotten so popular that they were splitting up into two separate groups and touring around the South. Bill Helms had been hired to be in one of these groups, and he spent a couple of summers touring with the Skillet Lickers. The story he was telling now, though, was more evocative than factual. And I could tell by the way he elaborated on it and circled around it that it was something that meant a great deal to him. He told about the time in the summer of 1928 when the Skillet Lickers had set up the stage and prepared to do an evening show at a small valley town up in the mountains of North Georgia. Actually, not too far, he said, from where the film Deliverance was made. The band, which was five of them, pulled into town in their two Ford cars about dusk, and at once set about getting their stage rigged up. Clayton McMitchin, the leader of the band and the lead fiddler, was a skilled mechanic, and he set up a little portable generator and began rigging the lights for the stage. Raleigh Puckett, the great blind guitarist who virtually invented modern bluegrass guitar styles, sat on the steps and began tuning up his instrument, while Bill Helms himself removed several boxes of Black Label Columbia phonograph records from the trunk of his car. The banjo player, Faith Norris, began assembling what he called his machine. This was his famous one-man band device that he had made himself, and his fame had reached even to the national pages of Billboard magazine. Helms recalled, quote, "It was made out of soap boxes with a pocket knife. He had got some strings off a mandolin, some off a guitar, some off of a fiddle, some off of an auto harp, and he had made different tones and tunes from each of them. And he had pedals on the thing and knee pads. And he could make music with his hands and his mouth and his feet and his knees. It was a mess." Norris got his machine together. McMitchin got his generator working. Everyone got tuned up. And then they looked up at the dark hills that surrounded them, and they could see their audience coming. All over the dark looming hills, tiny flicks of light were moving down into the valley. "They looked like a giant form of lightning bug," said Helm. "But they were in fact ladders hanging on the wagon and in the hands of the hill people who were coming down on foot and by wagon to the show, moving slowly to converge on the bright patch of stage in the center of the valley. I never will forget that scene," said Helm. "They went on and sold tickets and began playing the fiddle tunes like Joy of the Town and Liberty, but Helms never was able to get that image out of his mind throughout the whole show." We've always assumed that there was some kind of seamless continuum from the old hill country folk music of the South and those early Victrola records and radio shows that sought to preserve the music. And yet here was a remarkable image brought together the two ends of this continuum. Yet the scene was full of odd and interesting contradictions, sets of objects. There were the lanterns of the farmers and mountaineers who came in their creaking wagons and dusty brogans, set off against the new Model A Fords and sharp suits that the band had arrived in. There was the acoustic simplicity of the unamplified instrument played without even a microphone, set off against the boxes of new, neatly wrapped phonograph records lined up on the edge of the stage. There was the youth of the members of the band. Bill Helms himself was only 25. McMitchin was 28. Riley Puckett, the oldest, was only 36. It's about the age of a modern rock band. But their audience here wasn't made up of screaming teenagers, but there were as many old people as young. They weren't really doing anything that unusual to the audience either. They were only playing the old tunes that most of the members knew and could probably even sing or play themselves. And then there was Faith Norris' strange machine, a new machine built out of parts of a familiar machine.
playing old tunes like I'll Be All Smiles Tonight and Red Wing. Why did people flock to see this kind of show? None of the musicians was unusual or strange. They were all normal Georgia boys. The music wasn't the newfangled jazz from Chicago or New Orleans. Just what was the chemistry that accounted for this theme, and why had Bill Helms kept it alive in his memory over all these years? And what was its power over the people who heard it? In many ways, the problem in understanding these questions, or really understanding this scene, are microcosms of a much larger problem in trying to relate traditional culture to the broader outlines of cultural history. It was one thing that set the Skeldickers apart from its audience. It was one thing that created the chasm between the two, the magic that drew the farmers and mountaineers. In varying ways and in varying degrees, it was technology. Not just the superficial technology of Norris's machines or the band's Henry Ford cars, but the deeper technology symbolized by the phonograph record, the portable generator, the stage light. These young Georgia men had by instinct and by intuition embraced technology and transformed their folk art into something quite different. Though the Skeldickers were playing tunes in many ways the same way and at the same skill level that a lot of the country singers in their audience played, they were somehow now performers. They were somehow special. Technology had entered into the process of tradition in a new and complex way. And I think it's a tripartite formula of tradition, technology, and change that I would like to consider today. I think it's fair to begin with the observation that many folklorists today see technology as a natural enemy of tradition. Technology allows homogenization. It erases the ethnic and regional pockets of distinctiveness that are so important to beloved diversity. A McDonald's hamburger in Maine tastes just like a McDonald's hamburger in Alabama. Linguists at my home state at Memphis State are worrying today that film and TV are causing Southern students to lose their Southern accent. A nervousness about technology. But beyond that is a whole body of what might be called urban beliefs, which are even more revealing. What about the widespread notion in those households that first got TVs back in the 1950s? Some of you probably remember this. The widespread notion that the TV could also watch you. That the people on the screen could actually see into your room, just as you saw into theirs. My grandmother never appeared before a television set without being properly dressed. We told her over and over again that there wasn't anything to this, but she wasn't sure, and we couldn't think of any good reason not to agree with her. And a generation of early TV comedians, of course, got jokes out of this idea. Remember the old days when Sid Caesar used to joke about this sort of thing. It kind of fed into this paranoia. Or when color TV came on the scene in the 1960s, I remember some of my friends who were, I guess, members of counterculture telling me, prattling on about these strange, ghostly patterns you could see on the color TV set late at night after you had turned the set off. A belief used to good advantage in Steven Spielberg's film Poltergeist. I've collected stories about garbage disposal in the 1940s, microwave ovens in the 1970s, home computers in the 1970s. All these come with their own mystique and their own folklore. Stereo records and multi-track masters have given rise to the paranoid fantasy called backward masking, in which the believers assert that secret messages, usually of a satanic nature, have been inserted on the recording and can be heard plainly if you can figure out how to play the record backwards. Of course, according to some proponents, this difficulty is no reason to doubt the feasibility of backward masking. Teenagers supposedly pick up these messages subconsciously. I assume the subconscious reverses the messages when they hear them. I even recently talked to a writer for a contemporary gospel music magazine in Nashville, and he told me a tale that was related to this about gospel music. As some of you might know, the gospel music world is polarized now between the older traditional gospel singers represented by the Kingsmen and Blackwood Brothers and quartet music, as opposed to the new contemporary Christian rock group like of a typical one, Alarma, DeGarmo and Keith. And if you listen to the rock groups, their music sounds just like Led Zeppelin, except they're singing about Christ in between the wailing guitars. So naturally, these two gospel groups don't like each other. And this one tale is told by proponents of traditional music about a young missionary who goes to Africa and decides to take along his boombox and his success of Christian rock. And as he begins exposing the heathen to the good news, he meets with a generally good reception until he decides to let them hear some Christian rock tapes. When the first song begins, which is a very famous song that everybody in Christian rock knows, the elders of the tribe get very worried, begin shaking their heads and even leaving. Finally, the missionary stops his music, asks one of the elders what the problem is, and he says, "That music," says the chief, "the words they sing are the words that are used to summon up our devil god. They are evil." This nervousness about technology is not just a modern phenomenon. The great American writers of the 19th century, Hawthorne, Melville, and Twain especially, all complained about technology in rather specific and literary terms. But there's also some evidence for a folk belief of anti-technology. In the early 19th century England, for example, we have the case of the Luddites. These are bands of organized, masked, anonymous men who roamed the countryside from about 1811 to 1816 with the sole pursuit of destroying the machinery used in the developing textile industry. Historians like to see them as sort of counter-revolutionaries fighting the Industrial Revolution, and social reformers like Lord Byron wrote poems in honor of them. But new evidence is suggesting that the Luddites were not just a social or political force, but they were the product of an authentic traditional legendary. Luddites have always said that they swore allegiance to the king of, not to the king of England, but to a person they called King Lud, a figure some commentators have seen as allegorical. But there really was a man named Lud, one Ned Lud, who in 1779, in a village in Lincolnshire, broke into a house and in what the chroniclers called a fit of insane rage, destroyed two machines that were used for knitting hosiery. The people made him a folk hero because there had been sabotaging of these knitting frames for about 50 years. But now when anyone found a trashed knitting machine, they would start up by saying, "Lud must have been here." And by the time the Luddites themselves got their act together in 1811, Ned Lud had become a folk legend. He was now called Captain Lud or King Lud. And he was as much a figure as Robin Hood or Santa Claus, a shadowy, mysterious presence roaming the hosiery manufacturing districts at night, wreaking vengeance on the accursed machine. And the term Luddite has entered our dictionary as a synonym for anyone who has a violent hatred for technology. The verb that spurs much of this attitude toward technology, of course, is change. It might be that the cataclysmic social change that occurred during the Luddite era, when the English peasant was turned into a wage earner, or the more subtle shifts in lifestyles that occurred when the American middle class families brought a television set into the front room. Or it might be the simple effect on one family of a microwave oven. With the difference in cooking the microwave has, with its incompatibility with old traditional recipes, and with its general disruption of established foodways. Even when technology does not directly impact a specific folk tradition, people respond to it and to the change it represents in traditional ways. In fact, it's tempting to reflect on just how much our notion of change is bound up with the very notion of folklore or preserving tradition itself. One of our most potent forms of literature is science fiction, and it's a literature whose keynote is the acceptance of change, whose prime philosophy is that tomorrow will be different from today, and that the day after tomorrow will be different from tomorrow. Historians tell us that there were long periods in history, though, when the day-to-day lives of average people did in fact not change much, when stasis was the rule. For much of European history, from the 12th century to the 18th century, a son could expect to live a life about like his father. And a person could move from the 13th century in France to the 17th century in France and not really have much trouble adjusting to everyday life. During this period, we are told, science fiction would simply not have been possible. A story set 30 years in the future would be identical with a story set 30 years in the past or in the present. So there was no science fiction. But what about folklore? Was there tradition then as we know it today? Certainly there were customs, habits, beliefs, techniques carried on and preserved, but did the people then have the same attitudes toward these traditions as, say, people today have? Did they see them as links to their past, to their heritage, as symbols of their uniqueness? And to what extent is this modern notion of folklore, not only a folklore, but also the people themselves, to what extent is this tied up to this watershed period in history when people began to realize that the future would be unlike the present, and that change would be the rule rather than the exception? To what extent is the sense of tradition a reaction to this inevitability of change, a bolster against it, an anchor? Is it coincidence that the first modern folklore collecting by scholars like the Brothers Grimm occurred at the same time that the Industrial Revolution was making everyone aware of the notion of change? Was it coincidence that the same month Mary Shelley was writing the first real science fiction novel, Frankenstein, or the modern Prometheus, that Lord Byron was writing his own tribute to the new folk hero, King Lud? If there are any positive answers to this question, then we may have to admit that technology and folklore are more philosophically related than we think. The Luddites, of course, had it. Folk of England made their peace with the knitting frames. The tunnel workers and miners made their peace with the steam drills that sunk John Henry. The two-way TV stories vanished and the microwave oven legends are on their way out. Once technology is integrated into people's lives, it doesn't represent so much of a threat, and the folk paranoia dies down. People were not at all sure about gasoline-powered automobiles for about 15 years. Witness all the early tales about cars and their strangeness, such as the well-known motif about the man who shoots at the Model T so it will let the man it was carrying go. And after they have learned how to take these machines apart and tinker with them and customize them, cars became accepted as part of the culture. In other words, technology can become part of tradition. America's love affair with the Ford car is a good example, as is America's elevation of Henry Ford to the status of folk hero. One graphic example of how the folk can merge technology of the car with the tradition of the tall tale is heard if you can listen to another piece of technology, a 1928 phonograph recording by a man named Red Henderson. Red Henderson was a member of a band led by Georgia fiddler Earl Johnson. And he made a record for the OK label called An Automobile Trip Through Alabama. It's a remarkable record. It's not exactly a great, funny song, but it's rather a narrative. It's a story sort of chanted in front of a banjo piece. In this record, Henderson talks about how he bought a new Ford car and put in it 10 gallons of local pep gasoline and takes off on a tour of the hills and hollows of Alabama. I drove it 3 weeks, day and night, he said, and wired back for a new set of tires. And I still didn't need no local pep gasoline. When he encounters a bear, the Ford gets scared and starts shaking and stops. Red himself jumps out, runs, and returns later on to find the Ford over in a patch of broomstick, kicking and pawing at him. He asks the car what the matter is, and the car says, "Can't you see all those little yellow aerial planes landing on me?" Red looks, and he sees the Ford is under attack by mosquitoes, and they are landing on its hood and trunk and seeing it, and little black bumps are being raised on the machine. In other words, the machine or the car becomes vitalized and alive, while the mosquitoes become mechanized and turned into aerial planes. Later on in the same record, he embarks upon a technological variation of the well-known Fabulous Hunt story. Red describes how he used the car's ramrod, as well as some of his faithful local pep gasoline, and makes himself a gun. And with the gun, he's able to shoot geese, a bear, a deer, and get a mess of fish. In short, by this time, the new machine was, to paraphrase Leo Marx's phrase, a regular part of the garden. It was completely integrated into the folk culture that once feared it. Now, this integration of technology into folk lifestyle is something we haven't paid much attention to. It seems, though, that at least in part of what is reflected in the music in which I'm familiar, it follows a fairly consistent pattern. At first, the technology, due to its strangeness and its tendency to effect change, is viewed with suspicion or even paranoia, and it's the subject of negative tales and jokes. Then, as the technology moves closer into people's lives, they try to figure out ways to assimilate it. When this assimilation or integration is complete, the technology can then become a part of the continuum of tradition. Look, for example, at the way in which families are today using audio cassette recorders to preserve family folklore or culture, or more recently, video cassette recorders to capture family reunions, birthdays, rites of passage, or even to rearrange the way they view the pop culture on TV networks. Down at Mont Eagle Mountain in Tennessee is a remarkable wood carver, except he doesn't do his work with a knife, he does it with a chainsaw. People routinely, amateur musicians all over the country today, are routinely trooping into studios and making their own custom record album at their own expense, and they sell these through their own channels. Nobody has any idea of how many of these purely folk products exist. And I say folk products, not necessarily folk music. Music that's put on those records can be anything from gospel music to bluegrass dancing. But the records themselves our traditional products, and we have no idea of how many of these things exist. I was in one studio in East Tennessee last year who did a lot of this, and he happened to keep copies of all the custom records he had recorded. In 1 year, he had done over 200 of them. And if he's just one studio, I imagine there are at least 5 or 6 of those studios in each one of the states. So in general, we can see that the folks themselves seem to be more responsive to some elements of technology and the folklore to study them. One of the most striking cases of how technology can generate a new tradition or modify an old one is the history of an instrument that most of you probably knew with a great amount of horror, the pedal steel guitar. Most historians today agree that the sound of this instrument, amplified and artificial though it is, has been the most distinctive single component in country music for the last 30 years. In other words, it has virtually dominated the sound of music for 3 out of its 5 decades. If there's a universal symbol for the modern, slick, commercialized, masculized country music, the kind of music that generally represents everything that bluegrass and old-time music fans rail against, then that symbol is the steel guitar. On the surface, it would appear that any folklorist wanting to study a dog would stand about as much chance as a white mouse that a cat can be. And yet there are around in the South and Midwest certainly as many amateur steel guitar players as banjo players, probably more actually. And the popularity of the steel guitar is another case where the folk aesthetic is running counter to the folklore aesthetic. It seems especially appropriate to examine this tradition here today because this part of the country, for some reason which I don't understand, has been a center for this particular musical development. Two of the most important figures in pedal steel guitar tradition are Missourians, Speedy West and Tom Bromley. And after all, the International Steel Guitar Hall of Fame is located in St. Louis. And I doubt if many of you knew that. I didn't know. Haven't been there yet. This tradition and the development of the pedal steel has, as far as I know, never been examined as folklore and has scarcely been documented by this great country music historian. And yet the evidence we do have certainly indicates that the pedal steel guitar is a product of the folk imagination and the end result of a rich and complex music and music instrument tradition. As a starting point in this case history, let's begin by examining this scene that took place one hot July day in 1953, when successful honky-tonk singer Webb Pierce prepared to record in the old Castle Studios at Nashville's Tulane Hotel. Among his backup musicians, which included fiddler Tommy Jackson, a dyed-in-the-wool tradition if there ever was one, was a man named Bud Isaac, who sat before a strange-looking contraption called a double-necked Bigsby. It was an electric steel guitar. The platform was about 3 feet long, foot and a half wide, and had two sets of what looked like guitar necks placed horizontally on it. Four legs supported the contraption, and four rods ran from the guitar necks down to the floor, terminating in four pedals to be manipulated by the player's feet. Cables ran out of one end into a small suitcase-sized amplifier. By moving these pedals forwards and backwards, Isaac could alter the volume of his instrument, create unusual swells and doo-wah effects, and through the pedal rods attached to the strings themselves, even change notes and whole chords with his feet alone. On that July day, Pierce was to record a song that had been written to showcase Isaac's music, a song called Slowly. When the producer said, "Roll it," Isaac began his introduction, not realizing that he was creating a sound that would be as archetypal to young guitarists as Earl Scruggs' banjo roll was to bluegrassers, or Jimmy Rogers' blue yodel was to an earlier generation of singers. Slowly became a hit early in 1954, and across the country, young musicians tried to figure out how Isaac was getting his strange sound. It was another watershed moment in musical history. Some steel players tried to duplicate this sound on their non-pedal instruments, and a survey of what they did is really enlightening. Some of them inserted nuts under the strings so they could bend the strings with their hands physically and try to get the notes. Others tried to duplicate the trick with the bar that was used to note the strings. The pedal steel at that time did not exist as a mass-produced instrument, so innovative guitar players set about improvising their own pedal steels with everything from coat hangers and door hinges. All kinds of weird homemade electric machines surfaced during these early years, all aimed for Isaac's sound, but getting everything from banshee wails to psychedelic Hawaiian music as a result. Once musicians were able to actually see a pedal steel guitar, though, they were able to more readily modify their own standard guitars, and they set about doing so in the same way that an earlier generation of people had modified the Model T. Nashville session man Lloyd Green, for example, actually bought a Model T Ford gas pedal, a door latch, and a series of tie rods to put pedals on his own standard Fender electric guitar. An even weirder thing happened here in Missouri, where Tom Bromley, the son of gospel giant Albert, managed to catch up with Bud Isaacs at a personal appearance near Springfield and to ask his permission to inspect his strange new machine. Isaacs cheerfully agreed and Brumley stared for a long minute at the pedal system. Then he went back to Isaacs and asked if he would mind if he made a wax impression of the pedal. Again, Isaacs agreed, and pretty soon Brumley had rigged up his own homemade electric seal. Nobody knows how many of these homemade pedal seal contraptions exist today, but I have visited a number of older musicians who proudly will pull them out of the closets or garages or basements and explain how they rigged up theirs. And even after the pedal seals became widely available from commercial manufacturers, thrifty or poor musicians still continue to make their own. The events leading up to Isaac's 1953 recording are just as full of elements that meet our definition of folk tradition. Back in the 1920s, guitarists wanting a steel sound would use a variety of homemade ways to get the sound out of standard guitars. Some of them would put quarters under the bridge to jack up the strings, while others would put tops of tobacco tins stuck up under the neck of the strings. Many, like Sam McGee, whom I interviewed at Lincoln, Tennessee, would use the cotter pin off of an old Ford to slide up and down the strings. This was a long metal pin that he could slide on his finger, slide up and down the string. For years after that, you couldn't find cotter pins anywhere in Tennessee because all the guitars were picking them up. I remember that my own father used a heavy steel bar with a notch along the top of it that a friend of him had made at the old Katy shop up in Sedalia, and he played his steel guitar with this great big heavy bar. By the time the commercial industry caught up with their needs and came out with steel bodied Nationals and Dobros, the figures of the 1930s were moving on to something else. In the dance halls of Oklahoma and Missouri and Texas, the guitar players had discovered something called a volume tone pickup, which was a black Bakelite covered affair that picked up sound and fed it into an amplifier the size of a box of Wheaties. It had been designed for Hawaiian guitar players who were doing lounge work in L.A. or San Francisco, but the idea was appealing to the young Turks who were playing in the dance bands in the Southwest. Here they could play the same kind of takeoff solo that the fiddlers and banjo players and piano players were doing, and when a kid named Bob Dunn recorded with Milton Brown's Western Swing Band in 1935, he became the first country musician to use an amplified instrument. But the Bakelite pickup wouldn't fit all guitars, and for years Dunn and his pupils, which included an 18-year-old from Bob Wills' band named Leon McCullough, traded ideas and suggestions and rigged up homemade instruments to get the sound that they heard in their heads out into the audience. Somewhere along the way, some anonymous player, and we don't even know who this was, got the idea to put these guitars on floor stands so the guitar player could simply sit back on them. We have no idea who did this. It just suddenly seemed to spring up around the Southwest, but it was a tremendous innovation. A little later, somebody else, and we don't know who, began to rig pedals to this guitar. Throughout the 1940s, the instrument machine continued to develop, and key musicians became as much tinkerers as technicians and musicians. And while all the music they played was by no means in the folk tradition, their styles and their instruments certainly were. Especially in California in the late 1940s, the musicians themselves also began to have a considerable influence on the first generation of guitar manufacturers, that I should say electric guitar manufacturers. One of these was a man named Paul Bigsby, who would make the machines that Bud Isaacs would use on Slowly. People like Bigsby were part tinkerer, part cottage industrialist, part musician, but also very much a craftsman. They were not making chairs or basket or quilts, they were making electric guitars. But they were responding to a widespread and vigorous folk tradition, and they themselves became participants in that tradition, a tradition that would soon infuse one of America's major commercial art forms. And yet we know virtually nothing about how this tradition worked or how it related to the commercialism. To be sure, we don't really know much about how the guitar got into the South at the turn of the century, or how the banjo became a favorite instrument among Southern whites. But at least in these cases, we can plead this process occurred long before anyone cared or sought to document such vernacular music. That plea is hardly valid for a process such as a steel guitar, which occurred here as recently as 30 years ago. And I think if we can agree that the electric guitar can be considered traditional with a lot of black musicians, I think the question arises, why shouldn't we allow white musicians who want to play an electric guitar to be considered traditional as well? If Muddy Waters and Son House can play electric guitars at the National Folk Festival, why can't Charlie Lubin bring his electric guitar player up from Nashville when he plays? Now, technology has affected, without any doubt, traditional music in many, many ways, and we don't have time to go into all of them now. It's affected everything from the nature of the string band tradition, it's affected the instrumentation, it's affected the repertoire, it's affected the type of singing that's actually used. There's no question that what it has, in fact, affected the music tremendously. But if technology has affected tradition in some ways, it has also been a part of that tradition. Folklorists have always had a problem with what we call the folk aesthetic. Two examples of this. One of the things that we're starting to learn now, and part of this comes about as a result of Nolan Porterfield's study of Jimmy Rogers. Others are starting to come out as we learn how record companies operate in the 20s. One of the things that we found is that the records that were the big sellers back in the 20s were not our favorite records. They were not the records that all the revivalists and young musicians pick up. We, for example, like very much to listen to people like Charlie Poole or the Allen Brothers. Those people weren't bestsellers back in the 20s. The audiences of the 1920s loved people like Carson Robinson, Burns Dalhart, people that we can't stand to listen to today. And this is bothersome to us. Mm-hmm. Same thing is true, I think, of the problem of what some people call indigenous cultural revival. What about these bands in which you have a young musician coming down from the north and learning how to play with a local fiddler? And in a particular case that I think of in Tennessee, we have a young man who came down from New York City and has begun playing with a band over in the mountains. And he's been playing with that band now for 20 years. And yet, he is still considered by folklorists to be a sort of revivalist or an outsider. Well, as the man who leads the band told me the other day, he's played with the band longer than any other local musician has. So at what point do we have to keep pretending that there's some kind of a difference here? I think, you know, one of the things that we have to deal with is that the folklore aesthetic, again, is not necessarily the folk aesthetic. Another example of this, which I was thinking of recently today, is a couple of things I heard Grandpa Jones say. I was working on the Grandpa Jones book. I hung around him a lot backstage at the Opry. And that's a treat in itself. That's worth writing any three books to get him back to the Opry and listen to what goes on back there. But one of my friends who is very traditional minded had told me the day before, I wish Grandpa Jones would stop making his personal appearances with that electric guitar player and that electric bass player and go all acoustic. And I thought, well, you know, that'll be nice, I suppose, but I said, you have to remember that Grandpa Jones has been playing with an electric guitar player since 1943 when he made his very first record. He always used an electric guitar player. And yet Grandpa himself considers himself a very old-fashioned musician. One day backstage at the Opry, I asked Grandpa if he liked the drummer playing along with him when he went out and did his act on stage. He exploded in a rage and told me what he thought of the drummer. And then later on that night, I was watching with a certain amount of fascination this backup group they have on the Opry, the Carol Lee Singers. And I was always interested in the way these people can just pick up on a song immediately and come in and do background singing. But I noticed they never did it with Grandpa. So when he came off one night, I said, Grandpa, you just did a real pretty song. And I said, how come you didn't have the Carolee singers backing you up? And he just snorted. He said, well, we're trying to keep it country. It's obvious that even though Grandpa uses his electric guitar and electric bass, he has a very, very keenly defined aesthetic of what old-time country music is. It does not include the drummer, it does not include the Carolee singers, it does not include overdubbed strings, but it does include the quietly played electric guitar and electric bass. Now I want to close this by coming back to the problem we had about the skillet lickers to begin with, and why that particular scene so impressed Bill Helms that he made it into sort of a personal experience narrative. I think the answer came to me, or at least part of the answer came to me, in another story that I heard a few years later, told by Snuffy Jenkins, who's a marvelous banjo player from North Carolina. And Snuffy Jenkins liked to tell a story that was a little bit similar to that, about the time that they went out on tour back in the late 1930s with one of their first stage shows. It was basically a sort of forerunner to bluegrass music, but they too had a really nice stage set up. They had a little generator. They had a series of electric light bulbs strung kind of like Christmas tree lights around the edge of the stage. They used loudspeakers, which was something that attracted a lot of people. Oh, the loudspeakers. But at the end of one particular show, the whole audience had left. Snuffy and his band were up on stage putting up their instruments, and this one old codger kept standing down there at the edge of the stage staring at them. And he finally got nervous, and Snuffy walked over and he said, sir, can we help you with anything? And he said, nope. And he said, well, did you like the show? I assume you liked the show. Did you like the comedy? Nope. Now, did you like the fiddling? Was there good fiddling on that show? Nope. Well, I guess you like our gospel songs. You're one of those types that like gospel songs. And he said, nope. And Snuffy finally said, well, what is it you find so fascinating about the show? The old guy said, I was just staring at your light bulb. Thank you.
For a lot of shifts, we have some questions, I'm sure, Charles.
I started in 1920 with an old Spanish guitar. Seeing those Perry Marsh seat children just come by my father's store, and he played wine music on a old Spanish style. And he had a nut up there in the front.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, after you had such beautiful music, that I just learned, well, I was going to learn how to play one of those. So I got me an old knife, seeing finally got an old bar or some kind of piece of steel, and I laid it underneath there, and I started off with that. And then back in 1934, for sure, maybe a little earlier, I had an electric steel, left steel, what they call left steel single.
Yeah.
I still play that thing today, and I got a lot of kick out of that, and I was at the convention of the steel guitar players in St. Louis at the the hen here about 5 or 6 years ago, so I can verify what you're talking about.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
This is gratifying, thank you. I cannot consider the pedal steel as other than a part of traditional folk. I wonder, would you consider the idea of a definition, that which is taught and which can be learned formally? For instance, one of my students is a formal violinist who also, he's a Japanese American, also laid down a damn good electric bass and just for kicks goes around and wins film contests because he finds his style interesting. He has been taught formally through the whole tradition, but I can think of no place in the country that he could go and get credit for studying pedal steel.
Right.
Therefore, to me, it is by default a folk instrument because it cannot be a part of the formal tradition.
Well, also, I think, as far as I know, there's no proper way to play it. Everybody has a different way of playing that pedal steel because there are so many different ways now you can make the sound. And there's no real proper way to do it. So it is, I think, I know one of the things that always impresses me and impresses people when I take them to the Grand Ole Opry for the first time, especially if they're not from the South, they have never seen anything like a pedal steel. It is absolutely out of any of their realm frame of reference. And they say, what are those four or five things
those are pedal steels, and there really are usually four or five of them lined up. Yes.
Don't you think that it is quite possible that shortly it will be incorporated into a formal tradition? My school is the first one to give degrees in jazz.
Mm-hmm.
One now takes very difficult solicit in jazz improv. Believe me, they're tough, because the kids who do that are the elite. And it's a formal tradition. There are books, there are societies, the whole bit. And that this, it will not be long, and probably until this happens.
Mm-hmm.
But currently, there is an authentic, there's also an authentic folk tradition in heavy metal.
Yeah, I think you're right there.
The instruments are designed by the kids,
uh-huh.
and they're put together in different ways, and there is no formal place where one studies heavy metal.
I think that what this is really sort of leading to is the possibility that what we have talked and talked about traditional music, we have too often focused solely on repertoire, or on musical style. And I think that certainly the nature of the instruments themselves and to some extent the style can also represent tradition. I use this example with Sam McGee a lot. Sam McGee was one of my favorite guitarists who played a very unique style that he developed sometime in the 20s. And a lot of times he would play songs that were not at all traditional. My favorite song he used to play was Tiptoe Through the Tulips. And I asked him if, I thought, well, maybe he picked that up from his father or something. He said, no, I learned it from Captain Kangaroo TV show one morning. But he played it in a very old-fashioned way. And it was obvious that the style was traditional, as the song was. And I tried this idea of instruments as machines. I mean, to what extent is an instrument a machine? I tried this idea out on John Hartford last week. We were talking about this theory on steel guitars. And he brought up something that's kind of unique from a bluegrass musician's perspective. He said, to some extent, any new instrument is a piece of technology. And to some extent, I suppose by extension, any musical instrument per se is a piece of technology. Yes, sir?
I had the feeling from when I was a youth in grade school that a steel guitar was a wind guitar, and the gut guitar was a Spanish guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Is this for...
Yeah, that's basically still true.
From my recollection in my grade school days, we're going back into the 20s, you could buy a conversion kit for a Spanish guitar, which consisted mm-hmm. of a bridge and this bar that you talk about,
yeah.
and rebridge it and restring it, and you've got a Hawaiian guitar.
Yeah, and I think, have you also heard this? I have heard stories of people back in those days taking one of those conversion kits and also sawing out the sound hole and getting an old hubcap and putting in there with holes in it. Have you all, you've heard that, or?
Mm-hmm.
Which would be an even, in other words, making your own dobro that way. And I don't know how many of these things exist or to what extent it was done, but my suspicion is that it was done pretty widely. Yes?
To what extent does this lead to the idea of there is a sound which performers are attempting to achieve? There is, if you will, each culture defines the sound which it considers appropriate. And as we define that and the performance practice that leads to that, we define
well, you think, do I think that's valid? Or I think that's a defensible position. The term sound itself is sort of nebulous, but I think that that's certainly one way to approach it. I think we are going to have to figure out some way to come to grips with one reality, at least in traditional music, and that is we have this idea right now that at a certain point, what we now call country music stopped becoming traditional music and became commercialized. Okay, but the fact is that for three out of the five decades this music has been around, it's been sounding more like modern country than old-time music, and we are going to have to figure out some way to deal with the fact that this is a music embraced by the folk, even though it isn't to some extent a traditional music. Yes, sir?
Sometimes
folk technology doesn't work out. I think it was Sonny Osley, string on a 5-string banjo.
Yeah.
And he played it for a number of years, but he finally turned it into the back.
Right. Never did caught on. Benny Martin has an 8-string fiddle, and I don't know that it's caught on at all.
So here's the example of innovation experimentation that fiddles and it's just falling on the same system. You know, and then the thing that would interest me is how does this relate to companies that manufacture, commercial companies manufacturing? How do these ideas percolate up to them, and to what extent do they turn into an important thing?
Well, that's interesting to me too, and that's why I was, I knew, for example, the case of this one gentleman, Paul Bigsby, who himself was a guitar player and knew most of the electric guitar players on the West Coast. And they worked very closely with him in designing these. And later on, people like Merle Travis had tremendous input into the design of electric guitars with bigger companies. And this hasn't been researched, but my feeling is that most of these companies that began to design guitars in the 40s listened very closely to the musicians, because a lot of times a musician would come to them and want a custom type of recording. For example, there was a double-necked guitar that came out that Stevie West was using for a while. And one of the stories is that West found that one of the necks got in the way of his fingering and suggested that they lower the one neck and make it shorter than the first one. The guitar company very quickly accepted this. So there is, I think, a lot of response to a sort of grassroots attitude on the part of the guitar company. And I think that, and again, this is different. I don't think this was the case when Martin began making their famous guitars back in the late 19th century. They didn't pay that much attention to what the tinkers themselves were saying. They had their own notions of what a good guitar should be. But I think that this modern electric guitar movement is much more grassroots.
Synthesizers are still a good way in which this is happening, but synthesizers are starting to show up in country music today. Now, the use of the synthesizer is taught in composition in most forward-thinking undergraduate music schools. They're also used in high-tech bands, or sports venues, for example, in both pop, heavy metal, soul, you name it. But the synthesizer is used with there is a sound, you can actually specify amplitude, cycle, the whole thing.
One thing that I think is quite interesting now, anybody who ever played a fiddle has been astonished that you can play a fiddle tune on a viola. Mm-hmm. And nowadays there's a 5-string fiddle, you know, that's got to be quite popular. Johnny Gimble has one, and it's wonderful. I mean, it's all kinds of good harmony in it, you know. And it's nothing in the world but a viola, glorified viola.
Right.
And nobody would think that a viola could be played for a fiddle, but it is.
See, I think we have for too often assumed that if technology had any kind of impact on music, it was to somehow amplify or change the direction of the basic sound that was created from the acoustic instrument. And that's no longer the case. And it started not being the case with the steel guitar, the pedal steel. There's no way you can get the sound of a pedal steel on an acoustic instrument. It's impossible. That's a totally new sound that did not exist without the technology. Same thing is true of the synthesizers and some of the other stuff that's going on today. Which means that whether we like it or not, we're going to have to come to grips with the technology as part of the instrument.
Thank you. Thank you. cassette recorder about 3 feet above your head for the next 25 minutes?
Yeah. I thought that was great.
Took care of that very well.
Yeah.
There's always wise as you can tell.
Thank you.
just go from B right down to E.
Thank you.
Well, it's just kind of something different about it. Don't get all messed up.
Probably known down yonder ever since he was 2 years old.
got C.
I'm going to ride down to my
foot. I know.
Thank you. Thank you. Bonnie play with Wonderfully.
You do echoes of Ozarks, I think?
No, I don't.
I don't hear people do that too much.
No.
I heard Pete McCann do it once.
I always think of the little old cabin in the lane.
That's a good meeting. I don't remember who it is.
got it, it's more thin than a book with it, though. I mean, it's folded. I don't know. And then they've got...
Do they have that same chord structure?
Well, I don't know.
Boy, that's one of the prettiest chords.
But it's not that old a one. It says it's written by so-and-so in 1929. Of course, who knows where so-and-so... When they say so-and-so wrote something, a tune like that, they could have really taken some more...
opportunity yeah, the idea, yeah, but you don't yeah. sit down and decide, well, this is exactly it, and you know.
They take a little start.
Thank you.
that wreck the old man's song?
Nellie Gray.
That wreck or Nellie Gray?
Nellie Gray.
Darn Nellie Gray, yes. Yeah.
Signal for us to go